Namaste everyone. Welcome to the Arsha Sanyoga YouTube channel. My name is Medha. Today we have with us Swamini Nigamananda Saraswati Ji. She is a direct disciple of Pujya Swami Dayananda Saraswati Ji. She is also a teacher of Vedanta and Sanskrit. She lives at the Arsha Sanyoga, Arsha Sanskriti Teertha Ashram in Porbandar, Gujarat. So, Namaste Swamini Ji. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you to you also.
Shall we start, Swamini Ji?
Yeah, please. Yeah.
So, the first question. In other religions, there is usually only one holy book. But in Sanatana Dharma, we have many different kinds of books, starting with books in story form like Puranas and Bhagavatam, and simple texts like Prakarna Granthas, and also more advanced texts like Brahma Sutras, Upanishads, everything. But still, out of all of these different kinds of texts and books that we have, Bhagavad Gita is considered very special and very central to the whole Hindu Dharma.
Yeah.
Do you agree with this view? And if yes, then why is Bhagavad Gita considered special?
What you have said is correct. Bhagavad Gita considers the main scripture in general, all our Hindu people. But still, let me tell you, Vedavyasacharya, you know, you might have heard the name Vedavyasacharya. He is the pioneer of all our scriptures. Actually, Vedavyasacharya has compiled all four Vedas. Basically, all rishis are seers of the Veda mantras, and they have started to teaching to their own disciples. But when Veda Vyasacharya has noticed that there are many mantras are available, but there is no compilation. So this, what are in prose form mantras, he has given Rig Veda. A mantra which has some meters, we can put in some meters. He says this is a Yajur Veda. Some mantras, what we can sing. He says this is Sama Veda, and there are mantras are available regarding our physical health. They say it is Atharva Veda. So he compiled all Vedas. After compilation, he has written all 18 Purana. What we know. And there is one beautiful shloka to remember all 18 Purana in one shloka. It is like Madvayam, Badvayam cha, Bratrayam, Vatrayam Shivam, Annam pa Kuskam Lingam, Garuda Ashtadashani. So in all this, 18 Puranas are included. Suppose I say Madvayam, so Markandeya Purana, Matsya Purana, Badvayam Bhavishya Purana, and Bhagavata Purana. So all are in these 18 Puranas are included. So he has given us to these 18 Puranas. After preparing this Purana, Vedavyasacharya has thought, in Veda, Upanishad is the main, what we say, scripture. The Vishayavastu is very separate. So he has decided to write something on this Upanishad. So he has prepared Brahma Sutra also. Same Vedavyasacharya has prepared Brahma Sutra. And after preparing all this, then he thought, let me prepare Mahabharata also. So he prepared Mahabharata, and it is almost 1 lakh shlokas. And among this, our Bhagavad Gita is also included in Mahabharata. And he has presented Bhagavad Gita in the dialogue form between Krishna and Arjuna, we know. But in this Bhagavad Gita, he has comprehended everything. Even what he has compiled in Veda Mantra, what he has written in our Purana, even what he has given in Upanishad, the Brahma Sutra. So everything condensed form is available in our Bhagavad Gita. And I would say, if we have to face different type of situation in our life, then the shlokas of Bhagavad Gita is highly helpful to us. And suppose in Veda, it says there are two parts. Karma Kanda is there, our Gnana Kanda is there. So same is included in Bhagavad Gita also. So Vedavyasacharya has taken Karma Kanda as a Karma Yoga, even in second chapter, in many chapters, Upanishad, he has taken all Vishaya Vastu. And what is particularly Upasana is needed, that Upasana is also included. The subject matter of Upasana is included in Bhagavad Gita. So in all, if we see from all aspect, but Bhagavad Gita has included everything. So Veda Vyasacharya, actually he is the pioneer, but he has presented Bhagavad Gita in condensed form. So all scriptures, all Vedas, all Puranas, even Brahma Sutra, everything is available in condensed form in Bhagavad Gita. That's why it is very helpful to even common people also, even who do not know much Sanskrit, but still all shloka, if we translate in their own mother tongue language, it is touchy to each and everyone. That's why it is considered the main grantha of our Hindu culture. Right. Anything else? Yeah.
No, thank you, Swaminiti. That is the whole, it's very tough to study everything. I think the scriptures are very vast, but Bhagavad Gita is like a pocket book.
Everybody. It is a condensed form. Even we know in Dhyana Shloka, there is a one shloka. Sarva Upanishado Gavaha, Dogdha Gopalanandanaha, Partho Vatsaha, Sudhir Bhokta, Dugdham Gopal, Rutamma. So this is a condensed form. It's a milk.
Yes.
Krishna himself is a Gopala. That's why it's beautiful.
Yes. So Swaminiji, the next question is about the four ashramas. There are four ashramas. So please explain a little bit about each ashrama and also whether one has to follow them sequentially. Go through each one in order.
Actually, there is not only ashrama, but varna also concept. So Bhagavan has represented it. Varna ashram dharma. They say varna ashram dharma. So varna concept and ashrama concept. And varna means Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. But they are not from birth, not a jatita Brahman, Kshatriya, but according to Gita, it says guna karma vibhagatah. Chaturvarnyam maya srushtam guna karma vibhagashah. So all four varnas, Bhagavan has said, I have created according to predominant sattva, rajas, tama and karma. What they would like to do karma, according to, I have given this varna. And after this varna, Bhagavan has also created ashrama. And everybody knows there are four ashramas in our Hindu culture. One is called Brahmacharya. Another is Gruhastha ashram. Third one is called Vanaprastha. And last one is Sannyasa ashram. In olden times, this all student used to go to Gurukulam. And Acharya used to teach whole Veda in condensed form. So he teaches both Karma Kanda portion also, and even our Upanishad portion also. It according to Kathopanishad, I would say the teacher used to teach is both Shreyaha Preyaha. Preyaha means what we are interested in worldly, in this earth, and Shreyaha means what we are interested, what is our real nature. Both it should be given in the Brahmacharya ashram also. And when they are graduated, then they ask, what would you like to do? And generally they say, we would prefer to go to Gruhastha ashram. Then they are entered. Even it was a custom was like that. Okay, nobody can live without any ashrama. Anashrami na bhavet. So you have to select either of one Brahmacharya or Gruhastha, anything. So immediately after this Brahmacharya, they entered into Gruhastha ashram. And Gruhastha ashram is basically to let go two egos. When two people are married, you know, at that time, they have to let go their ego. Plus, Gruhastha ashram is generally to grow, to become a mature. For that only Gruhastha ashram is preferred. So two people have to live with each other. And even both two people, they have to give respect to their own both families. They have to mingle with them. And in this process, this both people, one who are living together, husband and wife, they both will grow emotionally. And when they become emotionally mature, they also have grow. They have they have name, fame, everything in this Grihastha ashram. They have money, everything. And after some age, when they have their own children, they are also settled, then they have to write to enter another ashram. It's called Vanaprastha ashram. In this ashram, they can have leisure time to live with oneself. They can do whatever they like. They are not have much, they should not have. Actually, they should not have much interest in Grihastha life. They should not mingle with all society. They can have their own place. They can hold japa. They can have their own shravanam, everything. And if they love this Vanaprastha ashrama, then only they can go in a sannyas ashram. It is not compulsory. Each and every Vanaprasthi should enter in sannyas ashram. If they are comfortable in Vanaprastha, it is good. So this is our lifestyle. This is the concept of living of Hindu. They have all four ashram. And sannyas ashram is meant for to know oneself. Otherwise, I can say, to know who is Ishvara, what is Ishvara. So that sannyasi is dedicated their own life for the scripture or for Ishvara. It's called sannyas ashram. This is four type of ashrams.
So, Swaminiji, does one person have to go through all in order? Because we hear stories of, say, Shankaracharya. At a very young age, he became a sannyasi. So he didn't go through the other three so visibly. So how to explain that?
There are many Upanishads are available. In one Upanishad, it's called Jhabala Upanishad. So there is a one story comes in Jhabala Upanishad. Janaka went to Yajnavalkya Rishi and he asked Yajnavalkya Rishi, Bhagavan Sanyasam Bruhi. So you tell me about sannyasa. Then Yajnavalkya say, okay. Then he says, Brahmacharyam Parisamaptam Gruhi Bhavet. The meaning is, having completed Brahmacharya Ashram, one should become Gruhi, but one should have Grihastha Ashram. Gruhi Bhutva Vani Bhavet. When one who are completed their all responsibility in Grihastha Ashram, Vani Bhavet. Means they have to become Vanaprastha, Vani Bhutva Pravrajet. Having completed Vanaprastha, one should become a sannyasi. Pravrajet means sannyasi. Then he asked, what you have asked, same question, Janaka has asked to Yajnavalkya, everybody has to follow this order or not. Then he said, Yajnavalkya, Itarathava also. Itaratha means there is another way also. Brahmacharyat eva pravrajet. A person can be sannyasi even from Brahmacharya ashram also. Even Gruhat pravrajet. If a person has developed vairagya, then also from Grihastha ashram he became sannyasi. Even Vani, Vanat eva pravrajet. So this is exception rule. So, but criteria is one should have enough vairagya. Then only they can enter from in sannyasa from any ashram. This is both ways are open. It is not only one order.
Right. Okay. So Swaminiji, while we are talking about sannyasis, generally we find that there are more of men sannyasis. A lot of people have this question that why we don't see so much women sannyasis. So are there any such women sannyasis mentioned in the scriptures?
Actually, we used to know there are many seers, mantra drashtaraha. There are many rishis are available who have seen mantras in their meditation. They all rishis are called mantra drashtaraha rishi. Same way, there are many females are also available. One who have seen mantras in their meditation, they are all called rishikas. They are rishikas. They are not sannyasi, but they are rishikas. And they have given, I know some names, you know, like Surama, then say Godha, even Gargi, in Kakshivati. There are many names, I know. They are not sannyasi, but they are all are rishikas. But in previous time, nobody has given sannyasa to female member. But Pujya Swamiji, when he has started to give sannyas diksha, at that time, he told us that he has one thought in his mind. Even we say, Veda is apaurusheya, means nobody is written by any person. Even Brahman, what we are saying, the ultimate reality is Brahman in Upanishad. He has no gender. It is no female, there is no male. Then why female has no right to take any sannyasa? For that, he has that thought and he has started to give sannyasa to women. So it starts. I know only from Pujya Swamiji started given sannyasa. And even in Pujya Swamiji's all Shishya Parampara, there are many female Saravedas. Even I think more than male, female also, I don't know. I didn't count. But there are many female sannyasis are available. And there are many people says that Upavitam, that Upanayan Sanskara is given only to boy. Mm-hmm. But even in our Gujarat, you might have heard name Dayananda Saraswati, one who is the initiator of Arya Samaj.
Yes.
He is from our Gujarat, Morbi. So one, there is one education institute here in our Porbandar. It's called Arya Kanya Gurukulam. So all girls are studying there and they all have that Upanayana. And every day they are doing fire ritual. And after fire ritual only, they are going to their own classes. And every Shravan Purnima, when this boy change their Upanayana, same day these girls also are changing Upanayana. So they have made some rules and somebody altered the rule. But Pujya Swamiji is the initiator who has changed the rule and he has started to give sannyas diksha to a female also. And we are also, you know, I consider myself is a lucky. So I have taken diksha from Pujya Swamiji.
Swaminiji, tell us about how you started your Vedantic study, the whole journey.
Actually, my father was a doctor. And even my brothers are also doctors. And I am half doctor. I would say I am half doctor. So I have my own pathological lab and everything. But my father had one disease in 1990. And it's called MSD, myelodysplastic syndrome. And in this disease, our bone marrow starts to stop to produce blood. And we have tried many doctors in all over the India, but nobody can cure this disease. And they say only one remedy is you have to give blood every 3 months, 2 months, whatever time required. So if hemoglobin is dropped up to certain level, then we have to give them blood transfusion. So we have started to give blood transfusion many times. So I have myself as given because being doctor. And still the condition of father was deteriorate. And one day comes, in spite of all our efforts, my father has passed away. At that time, first time, we all felt helplessness. At that time I felt, because everything was fine in our family, everything was fine, but still I felt helplessness because we cannot cure our father. And this something I can say is punya also, but this thought has started, where is the happiness? This thought has sprouted in my mind. And then I have started, you know, investigate each and every people's life. So when they all are fine when they are outside, but when we meet personally, everybody says we are not fine, we are not happy. So even rich people also, even poor people. Then I have, you know, concluded no people is happy. So if people are not happy, so still they are after happiness, then where is the happiness? So I tried many local Mahatmas surrounding me, but nobody can give me satisfied answer. So I have did my graduation in Ahmedabad. So I know Swami Vidyatatmananji. Once I went to Ahmedabad and I met Swami Vidyatatmananji, and I asked him, I would like to meet you personally. Then he said, okay. Then again, same question I have asked him. Then he smiled and he said, you can join some camps, you know, because Ahmedabad and my native is far away. So I have started his camps for 7-day camps, 10-day camps. So he has started to teach Viveka Chudamani. And when while I was listening, it is very soothing to me. I said, it is very nice, very nice. Then within 10 days, everything is over. Then I say, again, I have to go back to my native. What can I do? So I have recorded all Bhagavad Gita's, Swamiji's recording, and I have started to listen in my native. So after some time, I thought, this Bhagavad Gita, what Swamiji said, I have to accept. I should know a little bit Sanskrit also. So I have requested one local high school teacher, Sanskrit teacher, can you teach me a little bit Sanskrit? So he taught me Bhandarkar part one. Meanwhile, Swami Vidyatatmananji has asked me, you have to join 3 months course at Annaikatti. At that time, only first time I heard there is one Annaikatti in Tamil Nadu near Coimbatore. He sent me there for 3 months. So I have attended the 3 months course in 1999. So during this time, I was very happy. What I was seeking, no? That I think I will get answer in these scriptures. 3 months are also is not enough for me. And 3 months are also old. Then I met again Pujya Swamiji, Dayananji, and I requested him, I would like to join 3 years course. Then he says, okay, whenever long term will start, I will let you inform. So in 2002, Swamiji started again this course and I joined it. In 2005, it was completed. And in 2005, he has given me Brahmacharya Diksha. 2005. In 2010, he gave me Sannyas Diksha. So this is the journey.
That's nice, Swaminiji. You started with a 7-day course and ended up in a 3-year course. So Swaminiji, can you tell us a little more about the 3-year Vedanta course at the Annaikatti ashram? What all they teach? How was the experience?
I would say, one would like to study, you know, with a total calm mind, composed mind. So Annaikatti is the perfect place. So it is surrounded, it is inside the forest, surrounded by trees and forest. So it is a good place to study. And there is no responsibility for brahmacharis or brahmacharini except study. So our full day, we have dedicated only for study. So we have enjoyed our 3 years course and we have completed, I would say, 5 Upanishads with Bhashyam, Shankar Bhashyam. We have completed 5 Upanishads. Bhagavad Gita with Bhashyam and Paramarthananji from Chennai, he used to come there and he teaches us Panchadashi, some chapters of Panchadashi. And our acharya, we have 2 acharya, both have taught us Sanskrit. So every day we have 2 Sanskrit classes, 1 Upanishad class, 1 Bhagavad Gita class, 1 meditation class, 1 chanting class. And from morning, we have this Dakshinamurti, Abhisheka and everything starts at 5 o'clock. So whole day, they keep us busy, but still I think this is not enough. We should learn more.
Yeah. But
really, we enjoy it. Really, we enjoy. Very peaceful, serene, whatever I said. Beautiful place.
That sounds very nice, Swaminiji. So, Swaminiji, you were very lucky to know Pujya Swami Dayanandaji personally. I think there are many of us, especially my age, many of my friends who did not get this chance. So, we never met him. Me, Arvind, some of us never met him. Personally, we have just his recordings now to watch. So Swaminiji, please tell us some of your favorite stories or memories that you have with him.
Yeah. There is a one sentence in Sanskritam, Jnaninaha Lakshanani Sadhakasya Sadhanani. It means, what are the natural trait of Jnanis? It becomes sadhana for a sadhakas. For that purpose, I would like to observe what Pooja Swamiji is doing. Every time I used to observe Pooja Swamiji. And at the last, we have Brahma Sutra for 3.5 months. Pooja Swamiji took this Brahma Sutra. And at that time, except this, our brahmacharis, there are many visitors used to come. And our ex-president, you know, Venkat Ramanji, he was also one of the students at the time of Pooja Swamiji. And he also attended this all Brahma Sutra classes. And Pooja Swamiji was very friendly with him. Always after class, they both are laughing. They are talking different type of topic and everything. So what is the actual schedule? After one class over, Pooja Swamiji goes back to his kutya. So all some brahmacharis, they always follow Pooja Swamiji. And in his kutya, he sits always up. There is two rooms. In one room, he used to sit and many visitors would be there. And they start talking. If someone asks, I would like to see you personally, then there is another room. He can take that person to another room. So this always, I would like to watch how Swamiji talk with each and every people, in which way. So every day, this Venkat Ramanji is always there with him. But one day he was coming back from one class to his kutya. So there is one gardener. He's a very poor of this Aryakan Guru, Aviji. So he stopped Pooja Swamiji. And I don't know Tamil, but they both talked in something in Tamil. And Swamiji has, hold his hand, gardener. And he's something, he's petting him. He says, come with me. I understand. He says, come with me. Then both went. And Swamiji took him in personal room. They have talked. And then he come with laughter and everything. Then having seen this, I have noticed in Pooja Swamiji's eye, Venkat Ramanji also saying, and even that gardener, I think his name is Perumal, something was there. His Perumal is, his behavior with both extreme is same only. And why this is same? Then I have tried to find out why this is same. Otherwise, we are bossing with someone, we are kind to someone, but why he is same to each and every people? So that Ishavasyamidam Sarvam, that mantra of Ishavasya, first slok mantra, it comes in my mind because in Pooja Swamiji's eyes, everything is Ishvara. In Venkat Ramanji is also Ishvara, and even in that Perumal is also Ishvara. So that incident is still always remain in my mind. And another, there is a one in Shatabhishekam time. You might have heard I think 2011, then Shatabhishekam for Pooja Swamiji. All students of Pooja Swamiji decided they have celebrated Pooja Swamiji Shatabhishekam. So I think it was a 1 week program. And they did different type of archana of Pooja Swamiji. And lastly, they have offered gold coins. Ashtotara, they have done with gold coins. And different type of nritya, different type of dramas, they have presented for Pooja Swamiji. Whole week, they have dedicated Pooja Swamiji. And lastly, Pooja Swamiji has to speak. They have to address the all people. Then he spoke and he said, okay, have you seen the pipe, hollow pipe? If pipe has no blockage, so whatever you put from one side, it will come to next side also. So today, for 7 days, I'm thinking and I'm telling to Dakshinamurti, I'm like a pipe. He says, I'm like a pipe and there is a no blockage. This in my body, there is a no blockage, it's a hollow pipe. Whatever my students are offering for all 7 days, this every each and every offering, I am giving to Lord Dakshinamurti. There is nothing to me. So I am a hollow pipe. I have no blockage. This is also, I thought I should put in my daily life. Okay, whatever I do, okay, whatever everybody does, it's not our own. Everything is, we are here because of Pooja Swamiji's blessing. We are here because of Dakshinamurti's blessing. So whatever we speak, whatever people do for us, we are like a pipe. What you are doing only for Ishvara, are only for Guru Parampara. Nothing belongs to me. This is true message I have learned from Pooja Swami. There are many incidents.
Yes, it's very beautiful, Swamiji. When you tell stories about Pooja Swamiji, I feel like I should keep listening. You should tell more. I just want to keep listening. It's very nice. So Swamiji, what made you start the Arsha Samskruti Tirtha Ashram in Porbandar? And what are some of the activities that you do in the ashram?
Really speaking, I'm not an ashram person. Means I don't like, I don't know how to, you know, maintain the ashram. There are many, when we start ashram, there are many separate things. We have to maintain ashram. We have to take care of many things, financially, everything. And I don't know how to keep this ashram, particularly. Then after the finishing the course, Pooja Swamiji told me, I am coming to Porbandar. So I don't know why Pooja Swamiji will come to Porbandar, for which purpose, I don't know. And he came immediately after 4 months only. And he introduced me in the Porbandar, because she is the sannyasini, she will teach you something. Then after, when he was going, he said, again, I'm coming you. Don't say I'm not coming. Again, I'm coming to Porbandar. Then I said, well, so he says, after 1 year. So immediately after 1.5 years, he came back to ashram here, Porbandar. At that time, I used to live in one apartment. There are many, you know, halls are available. I used to take classes there. But when second time Pooja Swamiji came, so there are some students. I have few students. So one of students was a little bit rich. And he says, Pooja Swami, he said to Pooja Swamiji, I will give some land to this Swaminiji so she can build the ashram. Swamiji is very happy. He says, show me the land and place, everything. He took us to Swamiji and he showed this place, which I will give to Swamiji. Swamiji says, start planting everything, start planting tree. So everybody, everything will grow. It's look like an ashram. Then when Swamiji left, then I asked, shall we plant the tree? He says, my family member says, no. They are not interested to give me land. Then when again I met Pooja Swamiji, Swamiji said, what happened? When your ashram work will reach, then I said, Swamiji, this is the chapter is closed. He is not interested to give me land because their family member says no. Then says, then you have to purchase land. But you have to start ashram. So I don't know how to purchase land from government, what to do. Then say, you have to do. Only he says, you have to do. Then I say, okay. Then even I don't know. Then say, you have to first start some trust. Then I met Kalyaniji. Who is with me? Kalyaniji. She said, let me do something. So we both together, we have started one trust, Sanskriti trust. Then we have put application to government. Okay, we need some land. So our one well-wisher says, if you ask 4 acre from government, they will give 1/2 acre only. So for application, you have to put 4 acre. I say, okay. Then we have given application and I have written, I need 4 acres. Everything. But we know this is a government work, no? One from one table to another table, the paper never moves. They need sign something. But we never give any dakshina to each. So I never give in anything. So that papers are not moving. So whenever I met Pooja Swamiji, he asked, where is this, what is the situation of this, your land? I say, this is keep on moving. It is slowly, but it keep on moving. He says, okay. So once I met in Rishikesh, there is one Madhav Babu. I don't know, one is in Bhajapa. He came to meet Pooja Swamiji for some purpose. So he called me and he says to Madhava, Mr. Madhav, I don't know something. He says, please help her. So her whole papers of land can go fast. I don't know his mother. He says, please send me, but I don't know where to send. So I say, I will send it to him, but I don't know his mother. But again, he met in Ahmedabad. He asked, what happened to your papers? I say, Swamiji still is moving. So he's some, because he knows everybody in Gandhinagar, all ministers. So he asked, you meet this minister, he will help you. So I say, okay. But nobody, no minister knows me. So he says, okay, we will help you. Everything was moving very in slow. in meantime, Swamiji was very sick in 2014. And half lung was cut, was infection in lung and half lung was cut. So we have decided to meet him in Coimbatore. So we went and he was in ICU. Nobody was allowed, but we have come for Porbandar. So he allowed us. So when I asked him, Swamiji, how is your health? Well, he was very fragile. But if I start, no, before he asked, where is the ashram slant? At that time, I have promised him, okay, in any way, I will try my best. And then I have requested some people, okay, please, can you help me? And I met one Anandi Ben, who is now was a chief minister. Now she is not. Now is some. But she helped me without any money, but she helped me. And we have got all papers. And government has given land 4 acres. They have no cut. Fully they have given. And I requested Pooja Swamiji, because at that time, this all dialysis has started. So Swamiji cannot come over here. So I asked if you can do one brick puja in Anaikatti. So it will be blessing for us. So we are coming. Some Pooja Swamiji is ready. Big puja, vastu puja, in his own room. He asked one priest to do puja. He did all puja. And he has done that brick puja. Still we have kept in our puja room. And he says, during this puja, that Brahm priest used to keep one pavitri, one ring, is a grass ring. He has taken from that priest. He says, when Bhumi Pujan will start, you give this grass ring to your priest. So this puja will continue. It will be over, then Bhumi Pujan will start. So in this way, we have opened this, our Arsha Sanskriti Teeth Ashram. And Pooja Swamiji's reason only, he has asked me to do long year course, three, what I have done, same course you have to conduct. For that reason only, I have started this ashram. So nowadays, because of COVID, I have stopped for 2 years. But before that, I used to take a 15 days game, 30 days game. And now I will start 1 month course, 2 months, 3 months. And if people are comfortable, it will be converted into long-term course. That we are doing. And even we are doing for some slum area children. We are, there are 120 students are there. We are helping them in studying. And few students become engineer. They are becoming MBA. So we are helping them also. These are
activities. Yeah. That's very nice, Swaminiji. So Swaminiji, we are very happy to be learning Sanskrit from you from some time now. So these days, English is the predominant language everywhere. And Sanskrit is not so popular these days. They say Sanskrit is Deva Bhasha, language of gods. But some people also believe it is Vrita Bhasha, dead. Yeah. But Swamiji, tell us the relevance of learning Sanskrit. Why must one learn Sanskrit?
I would say there are many, many types of people in our universe, in this earth. But there are three types of people, let me say. One are spiritual people, one who are interested in spirituality. So this for such people who are interested really in spirituality, they should learn Sanskritam, because our all scriptures are nothing but in Sanskritam only. Otherwise, if they don't know Sanskrit, then how they have to interpret others' mind only? They cannot, they have their own vision. If somebody teaches us Gita Shloka, and if we learn how to split each and every word and what is the vision, is it totally different? So if we learn Sanskrit, for spiritual people, seekers, it is very helpful. In one way, this is a Sanskrit language is helpful. Second way, I will say, nowadays is a computer day. You know, everybody is interested in computer. So now these people who are interested in computer, they say, this our Sanskrit language is complete. And it is very useful in programming. Some artificial intelligence in this programming, this Sanskrit language is the perfect, even compared to English language. So they have started now in Germany, in America, they are also are interested in Sanskrit language. And if we take art people, the literature people, so this, it says phonetically, it is complete. Syntactically, it is a complete. So from all aspect, one who are really interested in literature, they can always see the greatness of our Sanskrit language. So in all way, Sanskrit is the best.
Swaminiji, what you said about the programming thing, this I had heard before, long back I had heard it, and that time I just thought okay, but after studying Sanskrit now for some time, I understand how actually it fits. It is like mathematics almost, the language.
It's so mathematics only.
Very, very precise, very structured. And I know we just say a lot of people don't understand who have not studied, but once they study, they will only see it is as structured as mathematics itself.
Very true. It is phonetically, even it is totally complete. We can put whatever we would like to put, you know, each and every word. Still, meaning will be the same.
Swaminiji, you have written two books on Anvaya, on Mundaka Upanishad and Keno Upanishad. Can you tell us what is Anvaya and why it is relevant, and also where these books are available?
Actually, you know, whenever I teach Sanskritam, I used to one common sentence is that you must be knowing, Ramaham Rugam Pashyati. This is one common sentence. Is that the meaning is Rama says deer, but in English, this is the Rama says deer. We can write like this only. We can't put deer says Rama. So totally meaning will be different. We can't say sees dear Rama. We can't say dear Rama, dear sees. We can't, in English, there is a one methodology, first karta, then last verb, and in middle, then always the karma, the object of the work. This is, but in Sanskritam, we can put this one word, Rama Hamrugam Pashyati. We can put Pashyati Ramaham Rugam, we can Rugam, the meaning will be remain same, not like changes. So in our all Upanishad, even in Gita, because of this, we can put words anywhere. Still, the meaning remain the same. So they can put the word anywhere. But for our understanding, if we keep like that, first should be the karta, last verb, and then in between whatever the object of karma and others, all karkas, then it will be meaningful. We can understand properly. When I was studying in Anaikati, at that time, I thought if I can put in Anvaya form, each and I have done, I think, Mundaka and Keno Upanishad. First Kathopanishad, it was at that time I was learning Sanskrit. But when Mundaka started, I start understanding what is language, what is Sanskrit. At that time, I have put in this manner, the first karta, last verb, and in between context. And not only I did this, but when we study Bhashyam, the Shankaracharya's style is, if one word, he gives the meaning, the understanding of this word. So in one mantra, I used to put in this mantra, what is the Shankara's reason for this word? What is the Shankara next? That in that way I have prepared this Anvaya, not only Anvaya, but the meaning of whole Bhashyam in short form that I have given. It is very useful. One who are seriously studying this Mundaka or whatever Bhashyam. And even I have split each and every, I have done dissection of each and every word. Like in English we say, in surgery we have dissected everything. So, which is the word, which is prefix, what is everything, in which vibhakti, everything I have done. So nowadays, these both books, when they are doing 3 years course, it is available in Anaikati also. They are using in Rishikesh also. But one person, Arsha Avinasha, there is a one website I have given to him also. So if you check in a website, these both books are available in soft copy also. So you can find out there.
Okay, Swaminji. So the final question is, any message that you would like to share with everybody?
I would say, Dulabha Manusham Tanu. This human form is given to us, is very rare. So it's given to us, so we should use it properly. We should live it meaningfully. So I always split our human being life in two ways. One, who are very young, they have to fulfill their desire. So let them fulfill desire with keeping all dharmas. Let them fulfill. And second line, what Pujya Swamiji used to say, give more, take less from society, even from environment. This is on another message. And while we are doing this, how we can give more? So only in Gita, we learn Pancha Mahayagna, this in Karma Yoga. If we live like life like this, we can give more to society. And in this process, we grow emotionally. We grow, and more we grow, it will take us to spirituality. And another goal of this human life is, we have to know really what is Ishvara, where is Ishvara, and why Ishvara is necessary in everybody's life. This is also each and every person should know. And lastly, being human being, we have to study our Shastra. If we cannot study Shastra, what you have asked previously, how Gita is used, each and every person should study Gita. And if we understand Gita, we can live life, we can face the situation, we can, we can face a pair of opposite. And in this all process, our mind remain always composed and calm. This is the message.
Right. Thank you so much, Swaminiji, for your time. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Medha. Even I say to you, thank you, because you have asked question. It's also good for me.
Yeah. Namaste. Thank you.
Namaste. Thank you. Yeah.